Hey everybody, welcome to the shop on a Saturday. Been busy, been taking that out of that because we went racing and because we finished in the top five, we got a free dyno run and we found out we're down on power. So we're gonna see if we can fix that. But let's not get ahead of ourselves. So you can see that the walls changed a little bit. I've taken the Green Mountain Boys flag and put it over on that side behind you, which is where the state flags are, even though the flag predates the United States of America. So maybe it's more significant than just a state flag. It's related to the Vermont state flag. I'm not an expert, but maybe it's a very significant flag because it's from the transition of the colonies to the United States. So it's kind of cool. Anyway, it used to be right there. And now we have two new flags. One of them is from Jan Zymanek, who's actually in El Segundo, California. Thank you for the biscuits, the cookies. The cookies and the Polish flags. There's two of them, and we put one up there. That's really cool. The flag was packed in cookies, and they're all gone now because they were pretty good. Okay, and then we have from Jerry in France. I work on bigger, way bigger jet fuel to thrust converters, and these pieces of engineering don't cease to amaze me. The GE90, which maybe is what he works on, is a piece of art when you see under certain angles, not only the fan blades. You would love it. The CF6 family still catches my heart when it comes to sounding with its unmistakable pitch. Long live to the jet people and full AB. And he says, P.S. Don't roast about the flag size. Could not find a smaller one. Find that hard to believe. And you'll notice it is actually the same size as the Royal Canadian Air Force flag, the British flag, and the German flag. It's the maximum size. It's too big, but it's just at the limit. Any over, and we'd have to put it on some other wall that doesn't get viewed as much. But thank you, Jerry, and thank you, Jan, for the flags and the stuff. And so, back to the racing. This video is gonna have a multitude of subjects. The racing was cool, and I'll show a couple seconds of footage of me. So I'm half a second faster around the track than last year, but to tell you the truth, I really was working on hanging off and leaning over farther and farther and farther, like the big boys do. And I really thought I was, but when you watch the footage, it's like, ho-hum, no big deal. That doesn't look anything special. But let me tell you, when you're out there and you're doing that, you think your chin is scraping on the pavement. So I still have some work to do, and we shall see how things go for the rest of the season. This question is from this morning, and it's from a person named Eaton Beaver. Eaton Beaver. I wonder if that's a real name. I don't think so. Anyway, he says, great video explaining the two spool engine. I do have a question though. On 757 and old L1011 aircraft equipped with Rolls-Royce RB211 engines, the engine instruments have an N3 indication. Does that mean that the RB211 is a three spool engine? If so, what is the purpose of the third spool? Well, Eaton, you're right. It is a three spool engine, and we are going to have, I believe this is episode 4 of jet engine diagrams, because I just got some copies made of some old ancient diagrams from the RB211 customer familiarization course back from, I think, 1969 or 1970. So let's take a look at those right now. Okay, Eaton, this is a diagram of an early model of the RB211, not the exact same one that's in the 757, and probably earlier than what was in the L1011. This was a development not so much a prototype, but it was an evolution of between the prototype and the production engine. So I know it's all black and white, sorry about that. I didn't have time to color it for you. But you can look at this, you can freeze frame and look at the details. We've got, let's start with the middle. There's a fuel nozzle. There's the combustor. Flames in there and goes through the stage, the only stage of the high pressure turbine. And the high pressure turbine drives, these three lines are so close together, they're just a blur, I know. But this is a big, fat cross section of a disc that is very strong, spinning very quickly. Sorry, I don't have the RPMs for you this time. So that HP system drives these compressor stages in a strange way. If you look, it's connected here to that, and they are connected in a mysterious way, but it's like a drum system. They're not individually connected to the shaft. They're connected up here. So this is the high pressure compressor driven by the high pressure turbine. And that is, the high pressure turbine's here. Sorry about that. Gas path goes through there. There's a turbine blade. I'll color it in for you. I don't know if that helps or not. Then we're gonna have another single stage, which is known as the intermediate pressure turbine. Would be called the low pressure turbine if it was a two spool turbojet, but we'll get to that. So this is connected to this shaft in the middle here, and it drives through a drum system. See, here's the connection. These are the different stages of the intermediate pressure turbine compressor. intermediate pressure compressor. This is all upside down to me. I don't know if you guys realize that, but to make it right side up for you, it's upside down for me. And so this essentially supercharges the high pressure compressor. The high pressure compressor, combustor, and turbine by itself comprises a gas generator. And like a turbocharger on a car, the intermediate pressure turbine extracts some exhaust gas energy and compresses the air to feed into this gas generator to make it more powerful, more awesome. And then we've got, after the high pressure, intermediate pressure, we've got this three-stage low pressure turbine, LP. And that connects to the inner tube all the way along here, all the way along. And it comes out here. And there's a bearing there. And this is the connection to the fan blades. So the purpose of the N3, now N refers to the stage that's encountered in order by incoming air. So N1 would be the fan, N2 would be the IP, intermediate pressure compressor, and N3 is the high pressure compressor, or the core. You could call this the core. You could also, within reason, you could call the HP and IP the core, if you really wanted to. That would be tradition, I suppose. And then the fan is driven by the low pressure system. A lot of turbofan engines have two stages. So the fan would be connected with the low pressure turbine. And that's a compromise, because now the low pressure system in a two-stage engine or two-spool engine has to turn a little bit too slow for the compressor than it would like to, and it has to turn a little bit too fast for the fan than it would like to. So it's a compromise. So what Rolls-Royce did was they built an HP gas generator that screams along, and they supercharge it with a wonderful, would be called a low pressure turbine and low pressure compressor, running at their optimum RPM, which is considerably faster than the speed at which the low pressure turbine and fan run. So the advantage of this engine is it's more aerodynamically optimized, and so it makes more power, and it's more responsive, it's more fuel efficient, everybody's happy. The disadvantage of this is obviously it's more complicated with three concentric shafts. This is a tube down the center of the shaft that conducts hot air to anti-ice the spinner cone, I suppose. So this is the magical radial drive shaft with another one at an angle down to the gearbox. Okay, so this is the inlet of the engine. This is actually part of the aircraft. It's considered part of the aircraft, not part of the engine. This darkened line here, this darkened drawing, this is the outer casing of the engine. Everything outside of that, except for the gearbox, is airframe stuff. Here's the airflow in the bypass duct. There's blocker doors here that fold in and reverse the thrust like this, at an angle about like that. And that provides most of your thrust reverse. They also add blocker doors for the core, for the hot stream exhaust for thrust reverse. This was found to be more trouble than it was worth, because at best it would only give you another 20% of thrust reverse. And so eliminating cost and weight and complexity is always a good thing. So this is a three spool engine. It's as if you had something like a Rolls-Royce Olympus right here, a two spool turbojet, low pressure, high pressure. If that was a Rolls-Royce Olympus from there to there, driving a power turbine, which is this beautiful three-stager right there, three-stage power turbine, and then had a cold end drive to a fan, you would have an RB211. Magic. So yes, the three spool engine, of course, the people who make this, they claim that this is by far the best way to do it. And it is a very popular engine. It's one of the most popular large turbofan engines out there for big aircraft. There are also other people making large two spool engines that are very powerful and very popular. And those people think that the simplicity and the reliability, the simplicity would lead to greater reliability and cost savings from less maintenance and less parts and things like that. They're both great. You can't say anything bad about either one. This is an elegant engineering solution, which is what we've come to expect from those people, of course. And the two spool large turbofan engines are certainly very rugged and reliable, and compete in every way with the three spool engine. So it's a beautiful thing. And there's a front mount. IP air takeoff. So this will be used for certain things, who knows what, in the aircraft. HP air takeoff, this would be used for other things at a higher pressure and higher temperature. Yeah. Well, that's, what have we got? Fireproof bulkhead is here in the nacelle. Kind of does that, and you're sort of separating. I'm thinking it does this, because you would separate the hot stuff from the cold stuff. Although the high pressure compressor is certainly not cold. The air leaving this is probably 600 or 700 degrees Fahrenheit. And I was just asked again the other day, wouldn't the fuel self-ignite? And that question is unimportant, because this air is 700 degrees. This is a flame. The fuel is being sprayed directly into the flame. So whether the fuel ignites when it's sprayed into a fire, or whether it ignites because it's being sprayed into a fire in 700 degree air, doesn't matter, does it? You want it to be burning like a blowtorch at all times. And look how small the combustor is. It's an annular combustor. And this area here, right there, well actually right about there, half of it maybe, a third of it, right in there, This is where all the power is generated. All the fuel is burnt because it's mixed with air. By the time it leaves here, there's no flame in that air. It's all very, very hot air, but it's not flame. And I think the last RB211 I worked on had 18 of these fuel nozzles. Yeah, it's a beautiful engine. And there's the wing of the airplane. This looks like it was probably it was designed with the thought of the L1011 in mind, because that was the launch vehicle for this engine way back when. And if you're wondering, oh, you can't see them. Well, I'm holding the paper down with these. See that? What this is, it's got a channel in it, you see? These are, oops, let's see, can I, yeah, right there. These things are what's on the inside of the case halves of a J79. The compressor cases go together like that. And these things are on the inside, bolted to the seam like that. And they seal out any leakage of high pressure compressed air gases from leaving the compressor cases. Super cool. Hope this diagram's clear. Clear enough. It's the best diagram I could find of a three spool. Well, let's see. There's one underneath it that we might want to take a look at. How about that? This is a bit different. It's the same engine. You got your spinner, your fan. This, see, it's a big tube that necks down to fit inside a coupling. It's joined to, again, one, two, three. Is that right? Well, there's a three-stage LP turbine. One, two. Yeah, and then one, two, three. Was I blocking that with my hat? I hope not. Anyway, so this is the engine case. This is a short duct. The bypass duct is very short. There's different ways of doing this. This is found to be slightly aerodynamically less desirable, but much more desirable in terms of weight savings. Very good then. So they call it LP, IP, and HP module, the O4 module we used to work on with the industrial engines. So it's all right here. There's the compressor, combustor, and turbine. That is an engine right there. And that engine's turbocharger is right there. And that turbocharged engine's mechanical output is right there. So it's a gigantic 60,000 horsepower turbocharged turbine engine, running a power turbine, if you will, to run a massive, gigantically powerful 100,000 pound thrust fan. It's a beautiful thing. So yeah, the equivalent is, you know, it's kind of a mushy translation, but 50 to 60 to 70,000 horsepower on the big modern RB211s. That is a lot of power. Super good. Okay. Well, I hope you liked that little discussion there. Diagrams like that are really rare, because showing the whole engine for the basic overview, that doesn't happen in the illustrated parts catalog, doesn't happen in the manuals. It's quite rare. It happens sometimes in advertisements, but it's less detailed. Those drawings are of a type that are very interesting to me, and they're really hard to come across. They're really hard to find. So like I said, those ones are from, I think, 1969. And I wish I could find diagrams like that of all the engines, but I can't. So for now, we're gonna have to make do with that. That is Jet Engines Diagrams 4. And if you have questions, send them my way. I'll see what I can to avoid them or possibly answer them. So, with the race bike under development for increased power and performance, at Jet City Turbines on the weekend. Thanks for watching.